Morning scripture is from Matthew 22, verses 1 through 14. Very familiar scripture. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fattened cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized the servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their cities. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet everyone you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. 'Friend,' he said, 'how did you get in here without wedding clothes?' The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'" So endeth the reading of God's holy word.
So this week we will continue on our series of the things that rob us of our gratitude. Now last week we discussed how anxiety and worry can stop us from seeing the blessings all around us. And in the first week we dealt with nostalgia and getting wrapped up in the past and missing the blessing of right now. Today we are going to talk about entitlement and how it stops us from being grateful. Now, entitlement is a word that has become very much politicized in our world today. We see people that say when students are asking for loan forgiveness, they're acting like entitled brats. And we see others saying that an aging population asking for the continuation of Social Security are acting entitled. I'm not here to argue these points with you today. I simply wanted to point out how the word entitled has become almost a slur in our world today. But if we take away the political aspect of the word, entitled just means this: having a right to certain benefits and privileges. The title for our sermon today is "It's My Grace and I Want It Now." I chose this title for today because as I was studying what it meant to be entitled to something, I kept getting these old commercials popping up in my head. And maybe you guys remember them. I think they were for like J.G. Wentworth or something like that. They were all over TV years ago. And it was someone had been injured or they had an annuity and they would say, "It's my money and I want it now," right? Those old commercials that kept running through my head when I thought about what it meant to feel entitled. And when we think about the definition of entitled, that is a perfect example. Someone was owed money for some reason and they want it. That is what entitled means, having a right to something. You see, being entitled is not necessarily a bad thing. To harken back to that Social Security for a moment, of course, people who worked in and paid into a system their whole lives are entitled to reap the benefits. You see, the problem isn't that someone might be entitled to something, it's that we forget to be grateful for that something. In our scripture for today, we see just what feeling entitled to something without having gratitude for it can cost us. As Jesus was speaking of the parable of the wedding feast, he told how the kingdom of heaven was like a great wedding banquet thrown by a king for his son. The king sent out servants to invite the other rich barons of the kingdom to the feast, and in response, they simply ignored the first request, and I imagine them saying something like this: "Of course the king wants us to come to the wedding feast of his son. We are so rich and powerful, we should definitely be invited." And when they don't respond, the king sends out servants again, and this time they kill his messengers. Again, I hear them saying, "Of course we are invited, but you know what? We don't need his feast. We already have so much. In fact, we don't need the king at all. Let's make sure we send that message to him in a way he will understand." Now, when this happens, the king is furious. He sends his army to destroy them. But if we look at what Jesus is trying to tell us through this parable, we can interpret it as this: God has tried to call the rich and powerful of his kingdom to celebrate his son. He first asked them to come to join the kingdom, and when they reject that message, he sent his prophets to tell them they were called to the kingdom. And when they chose to kill the prophets, God sent his wrath upon them. Continuing with the parable, the king turns to the common people. So many of them do what they need to do to prepare for the wedding, except for one guy, and he just shows up as is. Have you ever been to a wedding where it was supposed to be a formal affair and some guy shows up in his barn clothes? Do you remember the bride looking very happy when she noticed that guy wearing his barn clothes to the wedding? Probably not, right? I was once in a wedding in Oklahoma, and it was June, and it was southeastern Oklahoma, which gets pretty warm. It was about 106 degrees that day for the wedding, and it would have been fine if we'd have been inside in an air-conditioned place. Unfortunately, the wedding was outside, and the banquet was outside. And so I was a member of the wedding party. I had my tuxedo on, including my vest. And after the wedding, all the groomsmen and ushers were standing around saying, "Oh, I can't wait to get changed for this, the banquet afterwards." And we were just about to go get changed, and the groom came over and said, "Hey guys, my new wife doesn't want you guys to change out of your tuxedos. She would like you to continue to wear your tuxedos during the reception." And we looked at each other and said, "There is no way we're going to continue wearing these tuxedos in 106 degree heat. We're going to pass out." But we did it anyways to make her happy. To a certain point, she finally did relent, and we were able to at least take off our jackets and our vests. We still had to keep our dress shirts on. But we see when the king sees that guy in the barn clothes, he throws him out of the wedding into the land of darkness. You know, when we think about it in our terms for the world, we can see it this way: God calls all of us common folks to join the kingdom. It's an open invitation, but we can't simply just show up and expect that is all we need to do. See, there is an expectation of us that we will show God the respect that is required in order to be a part of the kingdom. Now, we do this by accepting Christ and that invitation, and we do this by living our lives according to his teachings. So what does all of this mean for us in this day? How does entitlement stop us from showing gratitude? Well, have you ever had something in your life that you felt entitled to? I know for me, as I thought about it this week, the thought of my junior year of high school soccer came to mind. See, I had been on the varsity team for 2 years and started as a sophomore, and I knew going into my junior year I was going to be a starter again. Except, for some reason, I wasn't. You see, an exchange student had come that year, and the coach felt that he was a better fit than I was. Now, what I should have done was worked harder, right? I should have put my head down and done the work. In short, I should have shown that I was worthy. What I did do was complain the whole season about how I wasn't getting enough playing time. It ultimately culminated with a screaming match between me and the junior varsity coach around that lesson. And in one of my prouder moments of soccer, I took my jersey off and threw it at him. Now, I was able to apologize and got to stay on the team, which was good. I did have a little suspension there. But you see, I felt entitled to being a starter. But what I should have been was thankful for the opportunity to be a part and play it all. You ever find yourself saying, "That's mine and I deserve it"? I know we can all probably point to something in our life where we felt that way, but there is a danger for us these days. See, what we find as Christians is at times we take the grace and the love that Jesus has offered us for granted. Indeed, we act as though we are entitled to that grace. It's my grace and I want it now. The truth, brothers and sisters, is this: there is not a single person here today, not inside this church, not outside this church, that is worthy of the grace of God. Now, it is freely given to us by Christ. That is true. It's simple for us to attain, believe, repent, and be baptized. It is easy for us to gain it. But that does not make us worthy of it. We have to keep that in mind as we go through life. We should be praying every day, "Lord, thank you for offering me your grace. I know I'm not worthy of it, but I will do my best to show you I'm thankful for it." Now, if we do not, if we simply take the grace that God gives us and we never thank him for it, then we are going to be like that guy at the wedding feast in his barn clothes. And if you think a bride gets mad when you show up dressed like that, I sure don't want to see how God's going to react when we show up and treat the gift of grace as if we were entitled to it. So let us be thankful for the grace of God. Let us praise him for what he has done for us. And let us show through our lives that we are thankful for him. My challenge for you over the next 2 weeks is this: what is something you can do to show God how thankful you are for his gift of grace and the invitation to join his kingdom? Amen.